From the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts. Ladies and gentlemen, Kid Rock.
I'm fast on a rough road, riding high through the mountains, climbing, twisting, turning further from my home. Young like a new moon, rising fierce through the rain and lightning, wandering out into this great unknown. And I don't want no one to cry, but tell them if I don't survive. I was born free. I was born free. I was born free. Born free. And free.
Ladies and gentlemen, Reba McEntire.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. Well, welcome to All Together Now, a celebration of service. And when we say celebration, we mean celebration. We're honoring the spirit of volunteering, the leadership of the Points of Light Institute, and the inspiration behind it, President George H.W. Bush. The Tree of Life is with us, symbolizing the renewing power of public service. This is an amazing gathering. Four United States presidents are here. I'm a strong believer in the power of volunteerism, so I was very flattered to be included in tonight's program. And when the organizers called me, naturally my first question was, how much does it pay? They said, nothing. I said, wait, you want me to volunteer? Well, let me tell you a little bit about volunteerism and public service. First of all, it differs from community service, which is what bad behaving celebrities are sentenced to do instead of going to jail. Well, instead of me telling you more about public service, tonight we'll be showing you some examples. We'll play some music, we'll hear from some of your favorite artists, and some of your favorite presidents. There's nothing new about America's commitment to public service. It's as old as our country.
Good evening. With four American presidents coming together in the name of service and volunteerism, tonight is a special occasion. And it's a perfect setting for us to remember that service is not something separate from our national priorities. It's fundamental to achieving them. It's one of the ways we come together to meet the challenges of our time. And tonight we celebrate this quintessentially American story. There are few greater acts of patriotism than serving your fellow American. Service connects us to something larger than ourselves. It enriches us in the life of the country we love. From the nation's very beginning, supporting and assisting one another meant survival. It's how we've grown stronger, block by block, and person by person. Today, the tradition of giving ourselves and our time to our communities remains strong, reaching out to help our neighbor, wherever that neighbor may be.
Service is a spark to rekindle the spirit of democracy in an age of uncertainty.
Serve your nation, beginning with your neighbor, building communities of service and a nation of character.
I've learned the secret that so many other volunteers have learned. You always get much more out of the work than you put in.
I've spoken of 1,000 points of light, of all the community organizations that are spread like stars throughout the nation doing good.
Service has always been a part of the fabric of our nation, and each of us shares the responsibility of carrying on that tradition in our own lives. Sitting with you tonight is a man whose life embodies that ethic of service. He's an inspiration and a true gentleman, and I join you all in saluting President George Herbert Walker Bush.
ladies and gentlemen, Miranda Cosgrove.
When President Bush first spoke to us of 1,000 points of light, I was minus 4 years old. But I grew up knowing all about it. Now in most of our schools, doing public service is part of the curriculum. In high school, students volunteer in soup kitchens, senior centers, hospitals, shelters, elementary schools, and wherever there's a need. These lessons we're learning as young people will last a lifetime, and my generation will be able to leave the world a better place.
Ladies and gentlemen, CeeLo. Ladies and gentlemen, Carrie Underwood.
There's a line in my song, Change, that says, "The smallest thing can make all the difference." That makes me remember a story the late Senator Ted Kennedy, a winner of the George Bush Award for Excellence in Public Service, liked to tell. This boy is walking along a beach and picks up a starfish off the sand. An old man asks him what he's gonna do with it. The boy says, "It got stranded up here by the tide. I'm throwing it back in the ocean." The old man says, "Kid, there's thousands of starfish stranded on the beach. How can what you're doing make any difference?" The boy turns to the sea, and as he throws the starfish safely back to its home, he says, "It will make a difference to that one." The world is changed one starfish at a time, one good deed at a time. Never think that what you do isn't important, because no matter how small it seems to you, well, it'll make a difference to that one.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brad Paisley.
Sister falling by the way, just stop and say, you're going the wrong way. You've got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, shine your light for everyone to see. If you try a little kindness, then you'll overlook the blindness. That you show every day is gonna help someone along life's way. You've got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, shine your light for everyone to see. If you try a little kindness, then overlook the blindness, narrow-minded.
Ladies and gentlemen, President Jimmy Carter.
I've been a volunteer, but if you think I had a choice about being a volunteer, you should have known my mother. Miss Lillian, as she was called by everyone, had combined the skills she learned as a registered nurse, trained at home, with the humanity that she inherited from her father. And she dedicated her life to helping others. My mother was serving in the Peace Corps when she was 70 years old. And if you think I'm too old to be a volunteer, then just look at my mother. And if you think 70 seems old, well, just look at me now. I'm still proud to be one. Rosa and I have been volunteers with Habitat for Humanity now for more than 27 years, going all over the world building homes for people in need. It's an adventure, and it's a joy. it never seems like charity, because we work alongside people that we are helping, forming instant communities. I can't think of a better way to promote understanding than what we're doing. I'm pleased to be here tonight to celebrate the spirit of volunteerism and to salute President George H.W. Bush. For everything he's done, we are deeply grateful. There's some people who see a need and just take it upon themselves to meet it.
The Mississippi River flows through the heart of our country and our history. Home to riverboat gamblers, Huck Finn, and a little boy who loved the river as only a child can.
You know, the Mississippi River is like my front yard or backyard, or my parents' house is 20 foot away from it. So that's where I spent all my time as a kid, fishing, playing, swimming. Yeah, from just when I was little, I noticed all the garbage out there. I mean, it's been used as a dumping ground for a long time. It was really just kind of like an open sewer. So I started asking around, is anybody doing anything about this? And finally came to the point where if no one else is gonna do anything about this, I will.
Chad Pragracki grew up in a riverfront town called Hampton, Illinois. As a teenager, he began saving money for college by diving for mussel shells. Garbage infested the river, his river, and nobody seemed to care. But he did.
No talk of the Mississippi River. It's one of the most famous rivers in the world. Who's gonna clean that up? No one, you know? They haven't in 50 years. And if I had to do it alone, then I would do it alone. All I was able to do the first year is just, you know, do it single-handedly. A lot of people definitely thought, you know, yeah, right, you're gonna clean up the Mississippi River. But to me, you know, it's just little steps.
The Mississippi is over 2,300 miles long. Chad knew he needed help. He put an ad in the paper and waited to see if other people felt as he did.
People came out and it was unbelievable. It was great. Everybody got out there on the river cleaning up, and I mean, they were tearing it up.
It worked beyond his wildest dreams. Schools, fishing clubs, and environmentalists all joined him. They worked their way up and down the shoreline. More people joining all the time.
We created an opportunity for people to go out there and do something positive. If you take them and show them firsthand how bad it is, that's when they're like, yeah, we really do need to clean this up. Plus, the fact that 18 million people drink the Mississippi water every day is a good reason to clean it up too. Basically, I've been doing this 13 years with the help of close to 70,000 volunteers, removed about 7 million pounds of garbage. You never know what you're gonna find. It kind of makes it interesting. I mean, you find bowling balls. A lot of mad bowlers out there is what I found out. There really is. I mean, we find them still in the bag where they just throw them off bridges or something after a bad game or two. I think we've pulled over 1,000 refrigerators out of the river so far. Close to or over 4,000 55-gallon barrels. We find cars, trucks, tops of school buses, tractors, sunken boats. I have the world's largest message in a bottle collection. I have like 63 of them, I think.
Chad was determined to get companies along the Mississippi to help pay for the equipment they needed. He didn't know any, so he opened up a phone book.
Alcoa started with an A. Boom, I'll start there. Just looked them up in the phone book, picked one of the 50 different numbers that's in the phone book, and just called up, got some random lady on the phone and said, hey, my name's Chad Pragracki. I want to clean a 435-mile stretch of Mississippi. Who runs the show? Who's in charge there? Him or her, whoever it is. I want to talk to him or her. And yeah, I didn't really go that smooth with her because she wasn't going to put me through the top person. But after begging her for 10 minutes, I actually got through to him.
Chad doesn't take no for an answer. He signed up Alcoa, then John Deere, Cargill, and nearly 40 other companies. He told them all, it's your river, too. And not just the Mississippi, He went on to the Ohio, the Missouri, the Illinois, and the Potomac.
But in the last 13 years, I have definitely seen a change as far as the amount of garbage out there. It's very tangible, you know, like you can see it. You can see your progress. I certainly am not taking the credit for that. You know, the 70,000 people that have come out, the volunteers that have come out, they should take the credit for it. And then we're just kind of part of a movement, really. I never set out with a grand plan. Pretty much just worked really hard, and everything's growing out of necessity. All these people coming together to make a difference. People come and volunteer for different reasons. Whatever those reasons are, I don't know, but I'm still in awe. Yeah. And I truthfully think that a lot of people that come and volunteer, regardless of what they think coming into it, I think they end up having a good time. Because you know what, it is fun. You do get to see results, and you're working side by side with a lot of like-minded people. And you know, all it takes is once, just go try it. And then once you get out there, I think you'll have a good time, and I think you'll volunteer again.
Chad was just one man with a big dream, to clean up the Mississippi. Today he is planting trees and reclaiming waterfronts all over America. Chad continues to dream.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chad Prodracki.
Thank you, President Carter. Thank you very much. Everybody here has done so much to support volunteering, but I want to speak to all the people who aren't here and all the volunteers, the thousands of them that I've worked with side by side, one-on-one, clean up America's rivers. And I'm just really proud to have worked with each and every one of them. I just also want to recognize all my sponsors that have made it happen. And I just really appreciate the honor to be here tonight. That's not on the teleprompter, I'm just, sorry. One last thing. This is the biggest deal. Like, this is what I've learned more than clean up rivers or anything. It's like, if you see a problem, know you can do something about it, no matter how big the problem. We all make a difference, and I encourage each and every one of you to do all you have, and I appreciate the honor so much. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot, man. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mavis Staples and Johnny Lang.
You may be an ambassador, king of a queen. You may like to gamble, you might like to dance. You might be the heavyweight champion of the world. You might be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Oh yeah, you got to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil, or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Oh yeah.
Drugs, a joke, a man, women in a cage. Oh, oh, oh. You might be a businessman or some high degree thief.
Hey, hey.
They might call you doctor, or they might call you chief, but you gotta serve somebody.
Serve.
Yes, you gotta serve somebody. You're gonna have to serve somebody.
Serve somebody.
You may be a preacher with your spiritual pride.
Yeah.
You may be a city councilman taking bribes on the side.
Whoa.
You may be a barber, know how to cut a hair.
Yeah.
Maybe on a paper. Somebody there, you gotta serve somebody.
Somebody.
Well, it may be the devil, maybe the Lord, but you're
Get out your blackberries. It's okay, I know you've been sneaking a look at them every once in a while. Oh yeah, little Reba can see you from up here. Now we're going to do some scheduling. We're going to schedule some volunteering. So take a look. How's the rest of your week? No? Right, it's the NCAA regionals. So next week's out too, the finals. April's no good. Spring break. It's also National Frog Month. All those cards to get out. Well, May's going to be a problem, too. It's both National Salad Month and National Barbecue Month. I know which one I'll be celebrating. Okay, you get the point, right? It's time to turn off the blackberries and start volunteering. Every day you wait is a wasted opportunity. It may not seem urgent to you, but it's always urgent to the person you're helping. If you don't know what to do, get in touch with our friends at Points of Light. You can find them at pointsoflight.org. Now, that would be a good use of your BlackBerry.
Ladies and gentlemen, Carrie Underwood.
Right on the head. You better get yourself together. Pretty soon you're gonna be dead. What in the world are you thinking of? Laughing in the face of love. What on earth are you trying to do? It's up to you. Yeah, you. It's the calm that's gonna get you. Look you right in the face. You better get yourself together, darling. Join the human race. How in the world are you gonna see? Laughing at fools like me. Who on earth do you think you are? A superstar?
Okay, kids, here's a tip. If you don't have a lot of experience in public service and someone asks you to volunteer, here's what you don't ask. What's in it for me? It's okay. I'm going to tell you what's in it, so you don't have to worry about blurting out what you're thinking. There's so much in it. There's nothing more satisfying than helping someone else. You know how you feel when you've helped a friend or someone in your family? They kind of expect it and really don't have a lot of choice, but you still feel great? Well, when you're helping someone you don't know, when you're doing it just because it's the right thing, you can multiply those good feelings by about a million. That's what's in it for you, and that's a lot. You don't have to work for the feeling. You just do something good and the feeling comes. It's guaranteed. It's the most amazing thing. Try it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Darius Rucker.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, President George W. Bush.
I love America because Americans have got such big hearts. We see it every day in the acts of kindness that take place all over our country. As President George Herbert Walker Bush, or if you're a numbers guy, 41, talks about 1,000 points of light. But as usual, he's being modest, because in our great country, there are millions of points of light that illuminate illuminating the countless examples of service and compassion that really define America, that makes us unique.
On January 12, 2010, a devastating earthquake struck Haiti. People the world over were stunned by the size of the catastrophe and the faces of despair. Haitians needed food, medicine, clothing. Many companies reached out to help. This is the story of one of them.
I think people help others because, you know, we're all people and understand that when someone is hurting, someone needs help. Everybody would like to volunteer, but a lot of times people don't know how to help and what they need to do.
Chip Chappelle had the know-how to create a plan. UPS put their people and resources to work. Teaming up with UNICEF, Chip devised a logistics plan in just 72 hours. It would send shipments of supplies to homeless children in Haiti. It began with a call to UPS workers in New Jersey. Would anyone give up a weekend to volunteer?
Thank you. Good morning. Hey, we have a lot of folks here. The local manager just asked her employees, can you make yourself available to assist on Saturday? So they all arrived on Saturday morning at our facility, and we all worked together for the children in Haiti.
Everyone who has felt powerless in the face of other people's suffering understands the urge to help. Scores of workers seize the opportunity.
I'm just trying to help as much as I can. It's just our small way of being able to contribute. Can't be there on the front line, so behind the scenes is just as good.
I just think it's such a tremendous opportunity to really make a difference.
I just wish there was something I could do in life where I made a difference, and this is the first time that I've been able to say that I actually did something.
They packed up everything a homeless child would need.
I had UPS people tell me it was like the best day of their lives, you know, the most fun they had ever had. And when are we going to do it again?
Let's do it again.
You're on any time.
Each of us has something to contribute. We gain in power and purpose working with others. These volunteers became a supply chain of hope. Relief efforts went on for weeks. Other humanitarian groups needed help getting aid to Haiti. UPS brought in 94,000 blankets from the United States, 100,000 pounds of high-energy biscuits from Norway, 21,000 collapsible water jugs from Denmark, 3 million pounds of vital supplies, including boxes for 50,000 children packed with loving care in a warehouse in New Jersey.
It was extremely gratifying to receive the photos of the children actually receiving the boxes, opening them up, trying on the clothes, and those photographs were shared with all the people that participated in putting the boxes together. I have been very blessed in my life. I'm a very fortunate person. I have 5 children and a grandchild, and I've always been able to provide for my children. And many people in the world, unfortunately, can't say that, and they need help. And so it's very easy to look outside your door and see people that need help.
Millions of Americans are eager to give to their community. More and more companies are giving workers the time and the tools to give back. Small acts building into large efforts. Angels in the disguise of ordinary people, acting together to prove that what we do in this life can make a difference, one child at a time.
It is my pleasure to introduce an outstanding citizen, Chip Chappelle.
Thank you, President Bush. I'm very fortunate to work for UPS. You know, it's not just a company, it's a group of people united by a common purpose. When there's a crisis like Haiti, you get to see a company's human side. I'm a logistics guy, that's what I do. I'm just a person with a particular skill set, and I was able to volunteer those skills. We all have skills, and through volunteering, we could use those skills for the benefit of others. That's what President Bush was talking about 20 years ago, and it's just as true today. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Heather Headley.
To share a problem that's enough.
Points of Light Institute shows us that whether we perform our service individually or in a group, we're part of something much larger, an international community of volunteers. There are benefits to being in that community, both to ourselves and to mankind. Public service breaks down the differences between people and promotes understanding. If you're working with others to build homes or dig wells or educate children, you don't notice the race or religion or nationality of that person next to you. You're noticing their heart and how that heart is driving their effort. And you notice that they're just like you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Nance.
I'm so happy to be here to honor my friend and mentor, President George H.W. Bush. The real lesson here is that you don't have to be the President of the United States to have an impact. With volunteering, you could be anyone, a single mother, a retired businessman, a student, an Afghanistan war vet. It doesn't matter. You have a contribution to make. It's not who you are, it's what you do. And we're all in this together.
Gary Maxworthy rose to the top of his profession in the food industry.
I had, you know, all the toys. My company supplied a country club membership. I had a Jag. But when my wife passed away in 93, it was my opportunity, I thought, to maybe do something different. Money was never really a driver for me. It was always making something happen.
He volunteered to work with California food banks to feed hungry people. When he started, all he saw was cans and boxes. Why couldn't food banks provide fresh fruits and vegetables? He set out to change what food banks could do. He convinced growers and packers to donate fresh food and bought the rest at a discount from supermarkets. The program called Farm to Family took off, delivering healthy food to those who couldn't afford it. Fresh, delicious food that lifted spirits as well. Today, after 14 years, Farm to Family feeds 500,000 people a week in California, changing diets and lives. For Gary, it was about more than food.
I get to see my grandkids. I get to spend time with my kids. They're proud of what I'm doing, so that feels the best, you know.
When you give back, you have this sense of knowing that you're able to help someone else.
Rhonda Ulmer was a single mother with three children. When she learned that her children's school was going to be shut down if test scores didn't improve, she went to see the principal and was in for a surprise.
She asked me, would I be interested in being the president of my children's school PTA? So I was like, wow, I'm just a parent at the time. You know, what could I actually do? But I knew that if we would be able to rally up other parents. So I started to think, if I'm, you know, as a single mom raising three children, you know, just imagine what other parents in the community may have been going through. Providing food for their families, health care, and housing issues. If parents are not able to meet the basic needs for their children, how are they really able to help them be successful in school?
Rhonda founded the University for Parents to teach parents how to help themselves so they could help their kids.
I mean, from a school that was on the Maryland State Department of Education takeover list was now one of the top performing schools in the state.
For me, serving is about giving yourself over to a good cause that is larger than yourself.
For Ross Cohen, service turned out to be the great journey of his life. After graduating Brown, he set out footloose to see the world. He was in the mountains of China when he heard the news and understood this was a defining moment in his country's history. He rushed home and enlisted in the Army. He was deployed to Afghanistan. His connection to friends, country, and a cause larger than himself gave his life pride and purpose.
I knew that I wanted to continue serving in some way.
After the Army, he found out how. By helping found Mission Serve, an organization that brings military and civilians together, uniting them in volunteer work, helping one another.
At the end of the day, you feel like you have not just made someone's life better, but also been a part of a larger team. And to me, that's an end unto itself.
That you and I, we mean something. This giving breath, this beating heart, it beats in harmony. It beats for you, for me, for every eye, every hand, every hour invested, every smile reciprocated.
A childhood in the South Bronx with no sense of the world beyond. When Tanya Ingram was 8, she joined an after-school program run by volunteers. They took her to museums and libraries. They introduced her to a world of books and encouraged her to dream.
They would tell me that I'm capable and that I shouldn't limit myself and that there's a world out there that's for you.
In high school, a volunteer helped Tanya prepare for college. She even took her to visit New York University. Today, Tanya's a sophomore, a poet with prizes to her name.
Take that seed, plant it in the life of another, watch it grow.
I wouldn't be doing any of this if it wasn't for the volunteering. The reason why I'm into poetry now is because I'm at NYU, because my volunteers helped me get into NYU. When you stop to actually just say, wow, this is because someone took the time out to invest in me.
She is also a volunteer, repaying the gift.
You never know the effect you're going to have. You just show up and you see what's going to happen. And that's the beautiful thing.
You are important now. Yes, we are important now. Don't forget this. When you are tired, when time stands so still, still know that all together, there was never a greater cause than this.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ross Cohen, Gary Maxworthy, Tanya Ingram, and Rhonda Ulmer.
Thank you. At first, I didn't even notice I was volunteering. Like so many of us, we didn't think that what we were doing was public service. We was presented with a challenge and saw it as an opportunity. Sometimes that's the way it happens. You get involved and something else takes over. You don't even realize you're a point of light until you see the beam. Muhammad Ali said, "Service to others is the rent you pay for your room here on earth." We're just paying our rent. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Reba McEntire.
College kids turning 21 in their senior year. Spring break was here. They headed south, but not for fun. Through thick and thin, where the storms have been, it was hard. Fixing windows and shingles and doors. Thank you.
takes her mama's hand and walks inside saying, please don't cry. As the people who built this house just for them laugh through the tears as the family moves in.
Everyday people are the ones who are making miracles, and it's beautiful. Everyday people lifting up the world like an answered prayer. I thank God they're there. They're the ones who care. Everyday people.
Ladies and gentlemen, President Bill Clinton.
Thank you very much. You know, when a president is about to leave office, most of the time, most people are dying for him to go on and get out of there. But there are a few little rituals that have to be observed. One of them is that the president must host the incoming president in the White House, smile as if they love each other, and give the American people a feeling that democracy is peaceful and honorable and there'll be a good transfer of power. You might be interested to know that the only thing George Herbert Walker Bush asked me to do is to preserve the points of light. And now, hundreds of millions of hours of volunteer work have been done. I've always been grateful that he asked and that I listened. So when I was leaving, and George W. Bush was coming in, the only thing I asked him to do was to preserve AmeriCorps. And he did. And I'm very grateful. I thank you. When you've had the honor of being president and your ambition is slaked and most of your fights are done, all you really want to do is make sure that by the time you leave this earth, things are a little better off than they were when you showed up. So I set up this foundation and I went to work. Then George W. Bush did me one of the great favors of my life. He asked me not once, but twice to work with his father to help people in need, first in South Asia in the tsunami, and then in the Gulf Coast after Katrina. All told, we took 7 trips together. It was an amazing experience. And this man whom I'd always liked and respected and then run against and a painful campaign in some ways, I literally came to love. And I realized all over again how much energy we waste fighting with each other over things that don't matter. It got so ridiculous, our odd couple partnership, that Barbara began to refer to me as her black sheep son, you know, the one that strays, there's one in every family, gets the politics wrong or makes some other mistake. This is a story that began with an improbable meeting in the White House between two people who had just fought a tough campaign, and all he asked me to do was to preserve the points of light. Now, as a result of that, he can virtually do no wrong in my eyes, even though he, every 5 years, makes me look like a wimp by insisting on continuing to jump out of airplanes. I love you.
Feels exhilarating. You get a physical charge out of it. It's just exciting.
That was the biggest thrill of my life. Ours too.
I'd say get off the bench and do something. Get in the game. Nobody's interested in people that just sit around and whine about things are bad. And get in there and try something. Help somebody else. Be a part of something.
He was born into a comfortable life in Greenwich, Connecticut. The Bush family believed that with privilege comes responsibilities.
Well, my father set an example for us. He was a very successful business guy, and he came out, and while others would go home and have a drink at night, he'd be the moderator of the Greenwich town meeting, which was like mayor of, in those days, of our little town.
A senator from Connecticut, his father believed in devoting time to one's country. His parents instilled the values by which George would measure his life.
Because we did have a reasonably comfortable life, like during the Depression, we'd get good meals and all of that. They just said, that's not enough. You gotta do something. Give something back. Be of service. And I felt that way all my life.
He'd been accepted to Yale and met the love of his life. Then America went to war. He enlisted in the Navy Air Corps.
I was commissioned an ensign in the Navy on my 18th birthday, and then I became a pilot. I liked flying off carriers. I liked the thrill of landings and takeoffs on an aircraft carrier. That addition to the whole concept of just pure service. As I said, I was a scared little 18-year-old kid. For the first time in my life, doing something that was important, really, and doing something that had some risk in it. It was defining for my life.
I was so young, I don't think I had any idea of how really awful this all was.
After flying 58 combat missions over the Pacific, he was shot down in 1944, then rescued at sea. He left the Navy with both the Distinguished Flying Cross and the memory of best friends who didn't return. George and Barbara set off to make their new life in Texas. It became their home. And it was here that he first ran for political office. Public service was always his calling and his life's work. United States Congressman, Ambassador to the United Nations, U.S. Envoy in China, Director of the CIA, Vice President, and then elected as the 41st President of the United States. At his inauguration, he delivered the same message to the country he had learned from his parents.
I've spoken of 1,000 points of light, of all the community organizations that are spread like stars throughout the nation doing good.
Well, points of light concept is that, you know, helping others, doing something for somebody else. And I believe in it. It's nothing we discovered. I mean, it's been out there for many, many years. Volunteerism, helping other people.
He established the first presidential office to promote volunteerism.
There's so many things that take no energy, really, but just thoughtfulness. You can go to schools and tutor a child one day a week. There's just a lot of things you can do. Certainly hospital volunteers are wonderful. I'm fascinated with the school system because I think that's the most important thing that we can do is to educate our children.
There were great changes in the world on his watch. An end to the Cold War with the Soviet Union and the building of an international coalition to fight the Gulf War. He worked across party lines, trying to ensure continuing opportunities for all Americans. Leaving is just another opportunity to start something new.
An important thing in my life now is the George Bush School of Government and Public Service here at Texas A&M University. I get a great satisfaction over the fact that these young people come here, and part of what they learn, or part of what they're encouraged to learn, is the idea of giving something back, the idea of government and public service.
The award that bears his name honors lifelong commitment to public service without regard for party lines.
Now, partisan politics means much less to me, and participating in these broader pursuits is more important.
And in times of tragedy, he became the face and force of the call to join together.
I call them the odd couple.
Bill Clinton and I established this friendship that really came from trying to help others. You don't have to be hostile your opposition. I don't think you need to be hateful about those people that disagree with you. And working with him, I think we'd established that. There can be no definition of successful life that does not include service to others. And I really feel that in my heart.
George is different from other people, truthfully. You can't find fault with him because he's generous and loving and kind. I'm sorry I said that, but it's true.
You can tell your opinion.
Thank you all very much. I want to particularly thank the other presidents that were here. Very grateful to President Carter, President Clinton, President Bush, and everyone else that participated in this. God bless you all, and have a great evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, Garth Brooks.
Crown thy good with brother.